Is a paid program. The content is provided by the advertiser. WPSL, its staff, management, and ownership are not responsible for the content. Investment involves risk. Prior to making any investment, an investor should meet suitability requirements. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future performance. Neither the opinions expressed nor the information provided constitutes a recommendation to purchase or provide investment advice. The material presented is not a substitute for obtaining professional advice from a qualified person or firm. Securities offered through Centaurus Financial, member FINRA and SIPC. And now, the host of the Team Martek Hour, Joe Martek.
Now, we were talking about our producer here. She happened to hang out with Trump a few days ago.
Well, I was there.
You were close.
There. Yeah,
you were only 2-3 rows back.
Yeah, I was actually front.
Front row for a while?
Yeah, it was very cool. Front row.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I was actually the dude who ended up on stage with him tripped over me in order to get over the railing.
Yeah, it was an interesting thing. You're telling a story. Tell that story about this guy. And
well, he was the first person there. He got there at like the crack of dawn and waited in line like for 12 hours.
Right.
One of the TV stations interviewed him, and Trump saw that interview
while he was on the plane.
Right, flying from Palm Beach to Melbourne.
Right.
And he spotted him in the crowd, and he went, "I saw you on TV." So he said, "Come on up here and say something to the crowd."
Did you see that? Yeah, yeah.
Well, on the way up, he got to me, and next to me was a wheelchair, and next to the wheelchair was a woman with a walker. He wasn't getting any farther than in front of me. So he went over the railing, grabbed up by the Secret Service so fast it would have made your head spin. He looked scared to death, and the Secret Service guy looked like he could have killed him.
Well,
and then Trump went, no, let him come up here. So,
yeah.
Well, you've got to remember the Secret Service is doing their job.
Yeah, but what's funny is... You're always like one person away. I mean, this guy got on. He like bumped into me and then went and hugged the president.
Neat. You know, hey, the boy's cranking. I'm telling you what. Every time.
You think they gave him a quick pat down, make sure he didn't have a gun before they
let
him up?
Well, they had him in a bear hug, and they had like 4 Secret Service guys on him.
Right now.
You know that had to perturb them, because their job is to pre-check everybody.
Yeah. I know.
Well, no, we were definitely checked. We went through metal detectors and all that. I'm sure there was face recognition going on, too. It had to be.
Don't we want that around our president?
Of course. Sure. It's got to be that way.
I was just saying.
I mean, if you don't think they're doing face recognition when you go into a stadium to go see a ball game, then you're in denial.
That's right.
Or at Disney World, even when you come into the different parks, there's places where lights hit you. You're being put through a computer, and you don't even know it.
And today's, it isn't even just today's. Look at over the years, the assassinations of presidents and or high up officials and or attempts.
That's right.
And hey, look at it. It's our job to keep the guy safe.
I mean, even the Pope.
Yeah, oh, everybody.
I mean, well, I talked to a guy once who was involved with Disney security. He says that one of the things they look for when children are missing, he says people will bring clothes to redress the child,
right.
But not new shoes. So they look for the shoes of the child as the first sign of recognition, because smart thieves do all kinds of things.
No, I've lost a child at Disney.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you found him.
Well, I didn't. They did.
Yeah,
security
found him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the
problem with
place.
Mine is he's not crying that he's been separated from the family. He's like happy to have shaken us.
Well, they told me was, he said, they'll drug them like they're asleep and carry them out.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just kind of reminds me of a story about my first grandchild, and my daughter at the time says, "Well, Daddy, he's never going to be spanked. He's never going to nothing. It's just the way it is."
Well, good luck with that.
Well, of course, we both know that plan fell apart.
Okay, good.
But the most exciting one was the kid was like 3, maybe 4, somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm.
And they were in Albertsons, old Albertsons on US 1 in Port St. Lucie, and the kid's missing. Now the mama starts to worry.
Mm-hmm.
Then they get on the PA system. Looking for this child, and everybody's looking for the child. And 20 minutes later, everybody is looking for the child, and the police show up.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
I mean, this becomes a major panic.
Of course.
Well, then all of a sudden, the kid comes out from behind a display, just smiling and grinning like crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And daughter of mine sat down, pulled down his pants, paddled the devil out of his rear end.
Make his little butt red.
And all the old ladies there were applauding. you know, that somebody, and nobody was, and the police were there, everything.
And because he knew they were looking for him, and he was hiding, and it was funny.
Oh, of course it was.
Until he got spanked.
Yeah, well, you know, if we ever noticed that when we were kids, and I remember vividly, I did not respect my father one bit, but I was scared to death of him. So I almost never did anything wrong, and if I did, I would rather have had the police take me and keep me in jail until I became old enough to go out on my own, mm-hmm. rather than let me go home, because mm-hmm. the fear of dad's reprisals was what keeps you out of trouble.
See, in fear of disappointment, what kind of kept me in line with my mom and dad, I didn't want them to think I was bad.
Mine was,
I didn't, you
there
know,
was
we were
no
guilted repri- into
was,
it.
Yes, and I can relate. I mean, my father did on a very rare occasion spank me.
Mm-hmm.
But it was never anything that you ever wanted to be part of. Okay,
no,
so it was
no.
a rare occasion, but it was like a really bad occasion.
I don't remember being spanked by my father ever, although I gave my mom a really hard time one time, and he grabbed me by my hair.
Yeah, but he
wasn't.
Like that.
He was. Yeah,
yeah,
I was. But I deserved it.
Well, my
I
grandmother
definitely
did
deserved
most
it.
Of the beatings.
With my
she
mother.
Had a broomstick.
We had a wooden spoon.
And I think I was about 12 or 13, and she was beating me with her broom. And then I just took the broom and snapped it and said, "There'll be no more beatings, Grandma."
We're done with
that
this.
That was it.
That was the last beating.
That was the last beating.
My father-in-law, he had it good. They, you know, normally the kids would be rowdy at dinner time, and they always had dinner together. The family did. So, and he'd be telling them to calm down. He was very low keyed. He never laid a hand on the kids ever. But inside one of the kitchen cabinets was a razor strap. The mm-hmm. old
oh,
kind
I remember
of
those
razor
mm-hmm.
strap. And he would open the door up, and he'd
just
say,
"Show it to them."
And he'd show it to them, and it would just calm them right
yeah,
down.
Yeah, that's always yes. hanging there, and
right.
you know it's hanging.
Is that the
there.
Nuclear option?
That was the nuclear option. Hey, did I ever tell you the story about how my brother saved my life?
I vaguely
tell
remember
us the story,
that one.
Joe.
I know. I know that I've got to because
yeah.
that was a good
but
answer.
We have new listeners who didn't hear it.
That was good. Yeah. Well, you know, we were talking about parents and fear. Now, my dad, Second World War, came out a captain, and he ran a military house.
Okay.
I mean, there was no mom and dad. It was sir and ma'am. I'm surprised I didn't have to salute. But, you know, he was 100% military.
I can go for that military bearing.
Oh,
I
yeah,
kinda like
it worked. It
mm-hmm.
worked. It worked magnificently. So, anyway, typical GI housing that was built after the Second World War up north, 3-bedroom, 1-bath upstairs and a basement. Now, the basement is where we ended up living because in the living room it had a couch with plastic on it.
That you couldn't sit on.
You weren't allowed in. Only the priest was allowed there, and he never came by. So that couch, I'm sure it's still alive to this day. Anyway, what happened is most of the neighbors would finish off the basement. The more mm-hmm. talent they had and the more relatives they have, they'd put tile on the floor and paneling and whatever.
So kind of like a rec room.
A rec room. Mm-hmm. And it became that's where we lived.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
he put a bar in, real nice, mm-hmm. bar stools and stuff. So I'm 12 years old. My brother's 7. We only had the two of us. And my dad caught me smoking. Now, I'm telling you, this was wrong.
I'm surprised. I'm you're here today to talk about it.
I'm no kidding.
I'm surprised you got caught, Joseph.
Well, you know, first of all, I wasn't the brightest bulb on a tree, but I got away with it for 2 years.
Okay, there you
because
go.
I started when I was 10. So my dad is behind the bar. I'm on the other side. Now, I'm not allowed to look him in the eye, and my brother's no dummy either. He's looking down. We're both standing there. My brother's afraid to move for fear he'll get killed by mm-hmm, osmosis.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad is describing how I'm going to die. I'm going to dismember me and beat me with my own, mm-hmm. you know. I mean, it's mm-hmm. just going to be a bloody mess because I'm not supposed to do that, smoke. So my brother's nickname was Sass. His real name is Eric, but he was called Sass. He had that look, and he grinned, and he could get away with murder. And my dad looks at my 7-year-old brother and says, "Sass, are you smoking too?" My brother says, "No, Dad, I quit last year, honest." And I think it's pretty hard to kill a kid when you're laughing.
Yeah.
So my dad just said, "Get out of here," for both of us.
Yeah.
But
mm-hmm.
anyway, I've often said that was it. It didn't stop me from smoking, but I got sneakier.
Well, mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. I can relate. I smoked till I hit around 25.
I smoked till I was 30.
Yeah. But yeah. It was like, I think I quit when they were, 40 cents a pack. And I said, "I'm not paying 40 cents for cigarettes.
Yeah.
I'm done." And I quit.
Yeah. Now it's, $5-6 a pack?
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, but hey, it's an addiction. It's a terrible addiction. Took me 3 years to get it out of my system, I'm telling you.
Yeah, but when you watch somebody like I did die from emphysema, you learn an awful lot. And you think about this. Would you run inside a burning building to take a really deep breath of smoke? Most people in fires die from smoke inhalation.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, that's
so
right.
Why do you want to inhale smoke?
But think about society, okay? If I watch the old movies, which I occasionally
it was
do.
Glamorous. Everybody.
Everyone smokes throughout the whole movie.
Yeah.
Okay. I remember smoking on planes. I remember candy cigarettes. I remember bubblegum
cigars.
Society, they put cigarettes in the GI rations and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, so cigarettes was part of our society.
Yeah.
Well, I knew lots of guys, clients of mine, that never smoked till they went into service.
Mm-hmm.
And then the guys that smoked could take breaks. If you didn't smoke,
you
didn't get
a break. Well,
so you start smoking.
It sounds like broadcasting.
Yeah. I got to go for a smoke break.
Yeah, everyone's standing outside for, 20 minutes.
Just hold it. You don't have to puff on it.
340-1590, 340-1590. We don't always talk about why we're here, but we always talk about something. And today
that's
the subject's kind of got
something, today.
Something got roaming around. We call this the Dan and Joe Show. Technically, because 90% of time, or at least 80%, that's who it is.
We're the only one who's
Dan and Joe, the only ones that show. This is Team Martek that started doing these radio shows, give or take, around 2004. We say give or take because none of us can remember exactly. But we do know it started before Francis and Gene, so that's our start-off date. The concept is very simple. Joe Martek's a financial advisor. I'm also called a stockbroker, securities principal, lots of licenses. Lots of clients here and in 13 other states, but literally, there's no such thing as any one person knowing everything. And in my not too humble opinion, if you are a credible professional, you align yourself with other credible professionals to help your clients. Now, one of the problems with that is guilt by association. If you recommend a person to one of your clients that does a poor job or treats your client poorly, that reflects poorly on you. So I just spit out my gum.
Anyway, you know where it went?
No, but it will show, I'm
it
sure.
Will.
Anyway, so Dan Warren, independent insurance agent, Greg Fasula, attorney, Joe Martek, financial advisor, started doing the radio shows. And the reason for Dan and Greg is the first two people, one of the first things I do when I meet a new suspect or prospect is talk about a will or a trust. And I feel it's kind of my responsibility to put the cart and the horse in the right order for people. If I'm going to be a financial advisor, it's called, hey, one of these days you're not going to be here anymore. What's going to happen to your estate? And as Dan often says, if you don't have a will or a trust, believe you me, the state's got it all figured out for you. And
they'll put your name on it, they'll charge your estate, and it's not going to go where you think it's going to go.
And it's not a pretty picture.
So, you have one.
Yeah, you have
You've
one.
You've got
right?
one, but wouldn't you rather do it right and have your assets go where you want them to go? And even worse, what if you did that up north?
Right.
So many people live up north, move down here, have already taken care of what they think is that will, and it's not in compliance with Florida statute.
Maybe if you don't like your family very much, then you just don't prepare.
Well, and I have heard people say, tough, I don't care. And I said, okay, then I'm done. I'm not going to talk to them anymore. But
do you like them better than you do Uncle Sam? At least that much? I mean, why give it away?
Yeah.
Well, in theory, they will look for blood relatives. In theory, but they're not going to look too awfully hard.
No.
That money can go sit in one of these abandoned family accounts for a long, long time, and the state eventually will take it. But the reality is this. So, attorneys. Now, what I would normally do when I was looking for an attorney, my client would say live in South Stewart. So I'd go find an attorney that was relatively close. I'd go interview the attorney, find out what kind of guy he was. And after the interview, I would say, okay, client, I met this guy. I think he's going to do a good job for you. Then I'd go with the client to the attorney, and very often the attitude would change pretty dramatically from a nice guy attorney to a pretentious, arrogant, not what I like kind of person.
Now, do you think, Joe, that some professionals feel that that demeanor is what's expected, and that's why they come across that way?
You know, the word expected is a good word, and maybe that's why they do it, but I just think some people, when they're talking to another professional, feel that person is on an equal plane. If they don't come up to your level of esteem, they may talk down to you, and I hate that in people.
Well, maybe part of that is then it proves that I'm worth the money that you're going to have to shell out for the paperwork I'm about to prepare for you.
Maybe it's part of the game, the demeanor that they want to put across. And maybe you and I think it's pretentious.
I do.
But then the client is a bit intimidated by that.
He's in awe. This guy must really know what he's doing because I'm already confused and I just sat down.
Get out your checkbook.
Get out my checkbook.
And the key is this: many people are afraid to ask questions because they are in awe and they're being the fellow is being pretentious and arrogant, and they figure, hey, he knows what he's doing, I don't, so I'm just going to sit here and not say anything, and I'll write him a check, and I'll leave, and thank God I get to get out of here.
And hope everything is exactly the way I need it.
That doesn't sit well with me.
I can't do that, because if I were to do that, and I were to come home, then my boss is going to ask me all these questions and say, did you ask this? And if I don't, because I know she's going to ask me, I'm going to get the answers before I get home.
Yeah, you better.
You say, go with me next time.
Well,
not necessarily.
Then it's like the running with mommy, so I'm not going to.
Yeah. You know, I've always said, one of the perks of getting old and you're retired, you go grocery shopping with your spouse. And I look at these poor guys doing this, and I'm thinking, boy, oh, boy, you poor guy. Did she lure you in here?
I rarely go grocery shopping with my wife. I usually get a list.
Let me just tell you.
Because I don't mind shopping, because then I can buy some of the things that I want that I know she wouldn't buy for me.
I avoid, like, the plague going.
I do, too.
My girl Barb, she may want two things on the list, but she wants to cruise every aisle.
No, Nancy's she won't do that.
She does a list?
She checks her refrigerator. She checks her pantry. She figures out what we're going to cook or where we're going to go.
Right.
And she says, these are the things we need. And I happily go get them.
Nice.
It's the hunter-gatherer thing. Yeah. The man wants to go in and get that thing.
Right.
But the biggest problem is this.
And the woman likes to gather.
If there's an item that she has a specific name for.
Oh, yeah.
I know I must find that specific brand.
You know, I
got to talk with the clerk. I got to say, I can't find this brand. Where is this?
I think all women do that. Is that true?
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, there's like. What is it? Hellman's mayonnaise.
Exactly.
Like, I could care less.
Yeah, I'm not eating that other stuff.
But it's better. How do you know
it's
better?
No, it is.
I can tell. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. Well, if I get the wrong kind, I'm going to get a lecture.
So you're starting to get trained, and that's okay.
Well, no kidding. Well,
I'm going to throw that other stuff away.
It's better than getting a lecture, you know, and say, now you got to take it back.
But the truth is, I want her to be happy.
There you go.
And if there's a difference between that mayonnaise and this mayonnaise that makes her happy, I'm going to get that mayonnaise.
Well, I'm going to say almost the same thing.
Did they break the mold after they made you, Dan?
No.
What he's saying is what I'm going to say. I just don't want to make her mad.
I want to hear about
so
it later.
We're both saying the
I'm
same thing.
I'm going to do it right so I don't hear about it later.
And I want to do it right to make her happy.
So we're both saying the same thing.
It's two sides of the coin.
340-1590. So Greg Fasula, when I interviewed Greg and I took a client to him, he was a nice guy. And he listened. And he wasn't arrogant and pretentious, and he was helpful. Then he wasn't expensive. Now, Greg hates it when I say this, but the truth is Greg was fair, and he's always been fair. And Dan and I, over the years, we have seen these attorneys that produce these great big books, and they stamp them with gold, and they charge a fortune for them, and nobody can read them because they're so full of fluff. And they get away with it, but then Greg... He skips the fluff. He gives people meat. No potatoes, no salad, you know, no dessert. You get what you need in these documents done professionally at a fair price.
And I would think that Greg could handle almost all accounts. I would say this. If I had someone who's worth, you know, tens of millions of dollars, I would make sure they got together with the accountant and the attorney at the same time, make all these plans, because that's so complicated.
You know what happens is I had a client some years ago worth over $25 million, and literally is what happened. I said, Greg, and he says, no, Joe, you got to go to these guys that have already gone to court and have this tested when they start doing these financial unbelievable family trusts and all kinds of different wrinkles that they can prove have been tested, because the Internal Revenue doesn't like people avoiding tax. They want to get their money. And the estate tax is 50%, which is a monster number.
And that's ridiculous.
Well, back when I first started doing this, the exclusion was like $650,000 that you didn't have to pay estate tax. Now it's $5.5 million that you can pass to family or anybody, and there's no estate tax. But over that, It's up to around 50%.
But any number there, that money has already been taxed.
Well, we all
many times.
We all agree on that.
No
However,
sense.
That is the system. So what happened? We're stuck with the system. I can complain about it, but I can't change it. Maybe over a period of time, but literally, it has been changed up to $5.5 million. Mm-hmm.
So for most, like I said, for most people, Greg's going to do magnificent. There is a place for that big gold bond book that. The guy charged them tens of thousands of dollars for, but it's not for most of my clients.
No. 99% of my clients fit into Greg Fasula. But every once in a while, this guy comes along with this monstrous. You know, what happens is normally it's a fellow that started a business, and then that business grew and grew and grew and grew, and all of a sudden, the appraised value, he started it off in his garage, and now he's got 150 or 200 or 300 employees and three shops, and it becomes a monstrous thing. The concept originally on estate tax was the family farm.
Yes.
Because grandpa would buy the property for $10 an acre, and now it's worth $3,000 an acre, and he dies, and the internal.
But see, that's just transfer to the people who loved him.
I know, but
well, it used to be called land rich and cash poor.
Yeah,
so when
yeah.
we would go in and do estate plans for clients that, let's say, live out west or have groves and things, we would set aside life insurance to specifically pay for that tax that was going to be paid. Mm-hmm. We did not want that client to have to say, well, sell off that section of land to pay for the estate tax.
You know, and there become, as part of the estate planning process, if they can qualify for life insurance, hallelujah, because now that'll pay the estate taxes. Now, let's just say the estate tax rule changes and you still have that life insurance, but life insurance proceeds are tax-free. So it's a win-win for the heirs.
And there's lots of things that people don't realize. I mean, I'd gone to some classes because, as many people may or may not know, the Medicare laws are going to start to change, and over the next 2 to 3 years, you're going to see some dramatic changes as they push us more and more into Medicare Advantage programs.
Of course.
That's how they're going to be pushing. But there are things out there, like a statistic I saw that shows that 60% of cancer costs are not covered by insurance. And I thought, well, how could that possibly be? So, you know, naturally I had to question the guy. He goes, well, these are the costs that are not covered. He was talking about travel. All the money that you have to pay to have somebody do things you used to do while you were recovering.
Custodial care.
Yeah, let's say you wanted to go to MD Anderson in Texas because you thought that was the best hospital. Well, they're not going to cover your flight. They're not going to cover your stay.
Right.
They're going to cover certain things.
Right.
So he said they have statistics that show all those other ancillary costs are what you go bankrupt over.
Yeah,
and so he's saying more and more people are now looking into cancer-specific policies that just say, hey, if cancer kicks in, here's your $50,000 to offset these costs. And it's not something that I'd pushed before.
No.
But it made some sense to me.
Well, there's going to be, as Dan was saying, as Medicare changes and as the health system changes, and now you know what's all going to change this year, how much Medicare is going to change, how much of the Advantage plans. You know, just as an aside, and Dan and I know this, we take it for granted, but if you get Medicare, Medicare pays for the hospital minus a deductible of $700 or $800, and I don't remember exactly. And then if you get Medicare Part B, it pays 80% of the doctor bill, which you then are responsible for the 20%. So you can go get a supplement that'll pay the hospital deductible and pay that 20%, and it costs you about $200 a month.
Now, and there are some doctors that are now saying, hey, I'm not going to accept just what they're going to pay.
Right.
You got to pay the difference also besides the 20%.
Now, however, Medicare really frowns on that.
Well, they do. They do. I mean, so there's lots of changes and lots of things on the horizon. And as I had told you a couple years ago, I thought Obamacare was going to implode.
Yeah.
I participated because I was hoping it would be better.
You had no choice.
Okay, so I participated. But now that I think Obamacare is going to be repealed and replaced with something hopefully that will be sufficiently done.
I don't even need it replaced. I just need it repealed.
Repealed. Yeah. Well, I need to get back to that market.
We were doing okay before.
Well, you know what
happens. So we'll figure out what to do after.
Back before I got to be an old guy, I would have a major medical with a $5,000 deductible. And the major medical, what I was mostly concerned about was cancer.
Catastrophic
heart,
care.
Catastrophic. Mm-hmm. Well, all of Obamacare all of a sudden became only catastrophic. I mean, we have a $6,000, $7,000.
It's like, why should all the ladies at my office have to have you know, pregnancy coverage.
Yeah, yeah.
It would be immaculate conception for these ladies. Or not. It's just not going to happen, okay? So, you know, but why force people to buy things they, A, either don't believe in, or B, are never going to be able to utilize.
340-1590, 340-1590.
Kind of like my volcano coverage on my homeowner's
policy. Right.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
But if you lived in Hawaii.
Zombie apocalypse.
Probably in Hawaii, though, you can't get it.
No, oh no. It's like earthquake coverage in California. It's a special rider on your policy.
Yeah. Hey, it's understandable. Speaking of Dan Woron, Greg was first, Grant, or maybe simultaneously, I needed an independent insurance agent. Why the word independent? Well, Dan and I both grew up in a captive insurance environment. I was Farmers. You were Nationwide?
Yes, sir.
Both good companies. Both do a great job. And in fact, Farmers is still out there doing its thing, but they also now have what's called an independent chain.
I sell through some of the Farmers lines, and I sell through Nationwide. So, I mean, it's not like I don't have access and sell them. And in all honesty, Joe, the captive market here in South Florida before Andrew wasn't a bad system.
Right.
Okay, because we had market availability to sell all these different types of products. When Andrew hit, major companies like AM Best, Standard & Poor's, Moody's came to these massive companies and said, your Florida portfolio has some concerns. We're thinking we may downgrade you. They said, oh, don't do that. We'll figure out a way to get rid of them. And they started these massive non-renewals.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the state came back and said, well, you can't get rid of them all in one day. You have to do it over a period of time. And so it was like a long, slow, irritating process. And hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people lost their insurance. And if you were a captive and had no other place to go, you were in trouble.
Not only was the agent, and it was guilt by association. If you're the agent that's been with these people for 10 or 15 years, and they like you and you like them, and all of a sudden they get non-renewed, and the people go into the agent, they say, Dan, you bum you. How come that happened?
Yeah, because you're the first bad guy.
You're the first
bad guy. I still have people I run into who said, you know, I would love to go back to your agency, but, you know, I can't deal with Nationwide. And I go, well, I've got like almost 100 other companies. We don't have to go there. And they're like mystified that I can do that now.
You see, and it's something we take for granted on a daily basis, but the average person, and that leads me into another subject in a minute, but the reality is this: the independent agent doesn't work for an insurance company, he works for the client, and then he will have, like under Dan's umbrella, there's up to 100 companies that cover all kinds of different things, and if one falls out of favor or decides they have enough business, they don't want any new business, or they non-renew somebody for whatever the reason is, he has 10 or 20 or 30 other sources. That might pick that person up.
Well, you know, it used to be if you took a large rate increase, let's say you have a company that doesn't take a rate increase for many years, and then one day they take them all at one time. The customer doesn't think, oh, it's been 5 years since I've had a rate increase. They think it's 25% instead of it's been 5% each year.
Right.
So that's when you have to have another market to shop for that customer. And I used to say, well, listen, in just a year or so, the other companies are going to catch up. You might as well stay where you're at. You've been there for a long time. Now I don't say that.
No.
I say each company must stand on its own. If they're not competitive, we have other places to go. And the reason I say that is the loyalty that I used to think the companies had to their customers, I lost that warm and fuzzy feeling when Andrew hit. When companies said, we're going to get rid of, let's say, 100,000 people. And I went to the company's agency boards and said, listen, if you have to do that, and I understand it, get rid of the 100,000 newest customers.
Right.
So those people that have been with me for 10, 15, 20 years, I can look them in the eye and say, hey, listen, remember me telling you about that brand loyalty would pay off? Well, I couldn't say that anymore because they treated everyone the same, and that's when I came into the decision that I have to find other places to put my customers.
Could they really, though, cherry-picked and pick the least risky people to continue doing
business?
They
said it was discriminatory.
Well,
couldn't they just say, hey, because I had them say, hey, if you're east of US 1, we don't want you.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that discriminatory?
Same thing.
Yeah.
So wouldn't it have been just as easy to say, listen, if you've been with us for 5 years or less, you're gone.
But I think that's probably why they didn't do the newest customers out
You see, what you know what
they
happens
probably
is,
assess. Well,
see, you're, you, here's what I
are
think.
Are you using logic?
No, actually, it's more of a conspiracy thing.
I think the newest customers were primarily newer homes.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm just telling you what I think. And that's probably why they didn't choose that. Mm-hmm. And the guy's been with me for 20 years.
So then they kind of did cherry pick the properties that were less risky.
They threw everybody in the same basket and said, you're all equally bad.
Yeah.
And, you're all bad.
Very bad. And my theory is, hey, if you're my customer for 20 years and you're my customer for 6 weeks, while I still respect the guy for 6 weeks, I should have more loyalty to the guy that's been with me for 20 years.
Sure.
Are you using logic again?
You bet. And I almost said something bad, but yes, I am.
No, that's more of a business ethic kind of thing than logic.
Well, what happens in life and in business and in politics and all the rest of it. Logic is a rare thing to me that works. And when we go back into, like Dan and I, one of our inside little conspiracy jokes is, our insurance commissioner in almost every state in America has never been in the insurance business.
Mm-hmm.
But they run the insurance commission, which makes them an expert, right?
Well, what was sad to me, in our great state of Florida, we have had insurance commissioners from many times who viewed that position as a launching pad for higher political aspirations.
Sure.
And I'm not going to name names, but it's real easy to go back and look. Okay. Now, who do you think those people are probably going to cater to? The public, who they're supposed to be the advocate for, or the insurance lobbyist who's going to give them donations?
And not, you know.
Maybe I'm skeptical.
Yep.
Maybe.
Yep.
But that's what I'm thinking.
All it amounts to is there's a whole case of life for the ain't fairs. But you know what happens is you have to adapt. You're not going to change the system. What we have to do is take care of our clients. So as things change, we have to change with them and do the best job we can for our clients.
Yeah, insurance is one of those things that it's really hard to live without.
Yeah, I mean, in our society,
you know,
you have to be so wealthy to avoid to be self-insured, and I don't even think you can be self-insured on an automobile. Can you?
If you have enough money,
but you've got to make a filing with the state.
Of course, it's like you can be self-insured on workers' comp, but you have to show tremendous resources, post massive bonds.
Yeah.
Usually, have to hire someone to administer the program for you. But if you've got enough. You know, money.
Right.
Almost anything can happen.
Yep. There you go. That's the rule. So that was the first three. Dan Woron, independent insurance agent. Greg Fasula, attorney. Joe Martek, financial advisor. Then over a period of the last few years, maybe more than the last few, we added Ms. Victoria Lloyd, Remax of Stewart, because the real estate debacle hit. When this last recession hit and real estate became a monster subject because the values of things plummeted. Then the words came out called short sales and HARP 2 and HARP 3 and all kinds of different modifications and lawsuits with lenders. So we had to add a mortgage person into the group because that also became a constant conversation. And that was Mike Paulus, mortgage broker. So the game plan was very simple. In putting together local professionals that have all been in business a long time, that all live in our local area, most of us, I think, we hope to die here, not necessarily soon. I hate to die first because then Dan would be the oldest guy.
I don't know. We'd have to find a replacement, John. Old
find another
replacement.
Old guy. So the concept is either to save you money or make you money, and thank you, Lord. We've been able to do a lot of good things for a lot of people, and I'm very, very happy about that.
Well, it's always nice, Joe, when I have an existing customer come and tell me how thankful they are that I referred them to one of our associates.
Yep, there you go.
I had that happen last week. I referred someone to Victoria.
There you go.
Ran into him for lunch. He was just speaking high praises of what she's doing for him to sell his house. And I thought, that's really nice to hear that. You know?
Yeah, that's right. We haven't even heard from Bulldog today, speaking of.
Well, maybe now that you mentioned, he may call in now
because she did a tremendous job for Bulldog, and she's continuing to help him, and he's moving again.
I can't even imagine. He just moved, and he's moving again. I just couldn't pack up my stuff
that's
twice.
That's the power of grandkids. You know,
and
that's what it is. You know, if mama's not happy, nobody's
happy. Remember what I told you about the Band-Aids making her happy with the right brand?
Yeah, right.
Whatever it takes.
Something wrong though, because my dream right now is to buy a toy hauler.
Haul your toys.
Sell the house, buy a toy hauler, and just drive around the country.
Well, that's not a bad dream.
I like that.
Yeah,
I can't get my family on board though.
But can you make a living doing that?
I don't need to.
Don't need to make a living.
I'm gonna live off the house. in my toy hauler.
Yeah.
Yes.
Why would you not do that?
I can't get my family on board.
Well, hey.
They like the house.
They like
do they like the security of the house?
The familiarity. You know,
because the house, maybe that's the what house it is. Has been there long before they were
We've
here.
Been working a long time to get that house to just, you know, perfect place. It's, you
all
know,
the above.
Everything is, you know,
a lot of people don't like change, and especially the radical
well,
change.
Well, usually that's me who doesn't like change.
I mean, I can relate. We had our the house we sold. We spent many years getting it just the way we liked it.
Mm-hmm.
But we decided it was too big and sold it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it can happen.
Yeah, see, I could never say too big. I could use extra rooms.
You can stack more stuff.
The extra rooms.
We didn't use them.
340-1590. Had a meeting this last week with a fellow that works for South Florida Water Management District.
Yeah. Oh.
And pretty high up. Been there a long, long time. In charge of a whole bunch of the programs that are going on. So I just said, I've got to ask you. What do you think is going to happen? Can this situation be cured? He said it's real simple. We have to open
Are
up
Are you talking Indian River Lagoon?
No, I'm talking South Florida Water Management District, which takes Lake Okeechobee down, everything to do, right? So, and in fact, he actually is part of the lagoon system north of the lake, too. So it was kind of in it. We'll
guess,
talk about that in
guess
a minute.
Guess who?
I guess I forced Bulldog to give us a call. Hey, Mr. Bulldog, how are you?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Saga continues, my man.
Yeah, it does. I like that toy hauler idea. I've been thinking of getting one of those, sticking my trike in the back. And
well, see,
going.
That's what I'd be hauling, too.
Yeah, pretty much. Sturgis is calling again. Well, you know, and then you got bike week. But hey,
it's
I'm
coming.
Gonna be in Palm Coast, so
you're gonna be close.
Gonna be a
You'll be right there.
Just a breeze for me, you know.
Well, you know, one of the problems is these adventures that we live out in our mind. If we wait too long, we don't have the good health to go and do.
Yeah, the body revolts, Bulldog. You might resemble that.
Yeah, I certainly do. I'm still waiting for back surgery.
Yeah, you
so,
go. There
you know,
go.
We'll see how that shakes. Ms. Vic is doing a wonderful job. You know, we'll get this sold, and Mike Paulus will help me, and we'll roll the VA over and VA loan over. And then, you know, everything, it seems to be going rather smoothly. It just... right now, we got to see where Mary Beth is. After about a 2:30 phone call today, I may call him and just say, pull the trigger. We're leaving in 60 days.
Well, hey.
Well,
that's the way you do it, you know?
Yeah.
You know, she's like, well, what about this house? What about this? Look, I'll take a weekend. We'll go up there. We'll look at houses. I'll pick one. We'll buy it. Thank you.
Make it so.
make it
work like that with women. I'm sorry.
I never knew that. Hey, Bulldog. Good talking to you, my man. Tell Mary Beth we said hi.
Yeah, certainly will. Thanks, guys.
All right, brother. Bye-bye.
Have a good one.
Bye.
Yeah, that VA is a wonderful, wonderful
program. No kidding.
What's great is that, you know, a lot of people – I guess I do realize it is something that's earned by the veteran. It's not just something that's given away. It's an earned program, and it's great that they're able to take advantage of that you know, the military does so much.
Oh, boy.
And protects us.
Yeah,
so,
and,
yeah.
You know, hey, and people like Bulldog that have been injured in the service of our country. I mean, let's face it.
It's like the veterans' benefits, you know.
And
then when I hear that they have problems with them or they're not getting good medical care, it just irritates me.
That's not even not fair. It's wrong. You know, there's some things that just should not be allowed to happen. But there becomes the bureaucracy of government.
When you mix money in government, you got a problem.
Well, you know, we're kind of hoping that the boy, the Don now is gonna.
He's got a lot on his plate.
We all
out here in America land want a lot of stuff.
Well, he never sleeps, so he's got the time.
Yeah.
Well, you know what it is. It's not that we want a lot of stuff. It's we want the stuff done right, fairly. We want it to run
properly. And too much has slipped.
There you go.
It's like quality control. Mm-hmm. We want him to be our quality control assurance guy.
Yeah.
And that's what we're looking. So speaking of South Florida Water Management District, I said to him, so what's the solution? He says, solution simple. you know, we just let it all flow south. And I said, so what that means is we have to kill everybody from Palm Beach County down. He goes, oh, yeah. The only way to do this is to open up the whole thing and let
everything in the Glades,
eliminate everything that used to be the Glades, and eliminate all the people.
I remember when they lowered all that land.
Yep, which also means there is no solution to that, but all they're doing is putting, you know, pasting this, pasting that. He was talking
about.
So
what they need to do basically, though, is lift Alligator Alley and let it flow.
Well, and they have done portions of that and Tamiami Trail. Mm-hmm. They're lifting it slowly, but there's more. There's more. They also are doing the rerouting of the Kissimmee north of the lake, and they're adding retention areas up there. All of this is in a scope of 100% fix. Probably the best it'll be is 10 to 20%. Then, he said, the biggest one going now is raise the lake level 9 feet. They have to increase the dike.
Oh, wow. What are they going to say?
No.
Yeah.
Well, it used to be much higher than it is today. Years ago.
That berm may not hold that.
It can't. The existing dike cannot, which means they would need to spend maybe $1 trillion to build that dike up that high with. It isn't just the dirt, because the dirt can eat away.
I've been out there recently. There's piles of rocks everywhere.
Everywhere.
I mean, they are still working on it.
Oh, I had a friend who began and ended his career moving dirt around the dike.
Yeah.
And ended his career.
Right.
I mean, it's a never-ending thing. Anyway, I just thought I'd throw that in for nothing. We got another caller. Rich, it's Joe Martek. You're on the radio.
Hi, Joe. How you doing?
Very good. Thanks.
I was just driving along, and I heard you talking about the estate tax, and I pulled into the IRS office, and I was just about to go in there with my question. I have my mom passed away on January 5th, and I was doing her taxes with my wife the other night, and we got through all the taxes. I got all her medical, everything done, and at the end of the taxes, it said that there was a form 1310 that had to be filled out in order to receive it. It has to be done by the executor of the will. Now, I'm the executor in the will, but it says that being that it's in the will doesn't mean anything. You have to have a court order in order to be able to fill out that form, and that's what I'm sitting here. I'm just about to walk into the IRS office.
Well, here's what happens. The rule, and let me just give you loose.
Yeah.
A person dies today if they have an estate, meaning their total net worth of less than $5.5 million, there is no estate tax.
Right.
If it's over $5.5 million, obviously every dollar over that $5.5 million, there is an estate tax.
Correct.
Now, over the $5.5 million causes another problem, because now the Internal Revenue is going to say, I want to look back, and did the person who died start to divert assets or give away assets more than they're allowed to lower the amount of the estate when the person died? So what the Infernal is looking for is certification that you didn't lie, cheat, steal, literally, you're going an nth degree. Unless mom left over $5.5 million, you're going to be academic. They're just going to say pass and, you know, go.
But what it sounded like to me, Rich was asking this, that he is responsible to file the taxes.
Of course.
And in his research, he said, even though the will says you're the executor, the court must rule that you're an executor to sign this specific form. Is that what you were asking, Rich?
Exactly, and her estate is much less than that. It's like $300,000 total. My name is on all the accounts, you know, all her bank accounts. So I wasn't even going to go to the courts. I was just going to split the money with my sister, which is what it said in the will, 50%, and do away with the lawyers, because my name is on all the accounts. I paid all her bills and all her medications and everything.
They're gonna say that's right. You know, I do this with clients all the time. I tell them, go to the bank, make sure they have a transfer on death agreement on your CDs, your checking account, your savings account, so it doesn't go through probate. The primary residence is not subject to probate. Annuities are not subject to probate. There's names on IRAs, or other retirement funds that have beneficiaries that are not subject to probate. Life insurance is not subject. So what happens is you're probably doing the right thing and doing an academic thing, but the reality is this: there was no reason to go through a court system based on your mind. I've settled estates in 5 minutes over the phone because what you're doing or what you've already done means there is nothing subject to the court system.
Right. That's how I figure it, too. Yep. It's just that, you know, with the tax, in order for me to be able to file, she's going to get a $4,000 refund, which she was alive for all last year. But in order for me to file it, I have to do that 13K.
Hey, I understand. But now, I think you're doing the right thing. Go in
now,
there.
Are you really obligated to file those taxes? I mean.
Oh, yeah.
If you want the refund, you are probably.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. I'm not an expert. Here's what I would do in my naive way. I would sign that thing.
Yeah.
I would attach a copy of the will that says where I'm the executor, and I'd say, here's a copy of where I'm the executor. If you have any questions, call me.
Yeah, right. I'm doing it electronically through TurboTax.
Yeah.
I don't think you're going to have a problem, but you're there. And, you know, let me tell you this. The new IRS, which unfortunately I have to see on occasion with different clients, they're very friendly, and they've been very cooperative. It isn't the old system where they intimidate you when you go in. They actually try. It seems like they try to help.
If you make an appointment.
Yeah, I hope you made an appointment.
No, I didn't.
Well,
you'll be waiting for a while, brother.
You know, I hope you, did you pack lunch and dinner?
I was just going to say, grab lunch first.
when you get in there, before, you know, when you first talk to the person, when you go up there, just say, hey, I didn't make an appointment. What do you think? And he says, well, there's 20 people ahead of you. Make an appointment.
Yeah,
make an appointment and come back next week. Yeah,
but that's right down the road from my house in Port St. Lucie, so
okay.
That's no problem.
All right, my man. Listen, any way we can help you, but I think
when you get the answer, call us back so we know.
Okay, I certainly will.
All right, Rich.
Have a good day, Rich.
Thank you for your help.
Thanks,
buddy. Thank you.
340-1590. Yeah,
keep those headphones on.
Yep, we got another call here. Maybe.
Hold on.
Our producer is pushing.
Yeah,
buttons.
The other button didn't.
The other button didn't work.
Didn't release. Victoria, are you there?
This might be Ms. Victoria.
I may have cut her off. Oh, she's
now,
there.
Wait a minute.
There she is.
She's talking to a client in the background.
Yeah.
Hey, Vic. Can you hear us?
I can't hear you. The story goes I was heading to Fort Pierce, and this type of business, that's why I tell them my business is in my car. I'm already in Hope Sound. I had to head this way, so I'm sorry I wasn't able to be there today, but things are popping just a little bit better right now, so people are starting to call more now.
That's a good thing.
Well, you know, this is, quote, the height of season, right? And usually February, March, April become crazy here, right, in real estate?
They do. And we noticed it was like almost for a week and a half, 2 weeks, it was kind of eerie slow again. And it's like, what's going on? And then all of a sudden the phones are starting to ring a little bit more, but people are starting to show. We had a new listing, and there's already two showings this morning. So, and it's at every price range, and that's the interesting part. You know, it's not just the lowest, and it's not just the highest. It's like a big range of different things that people are wanting to see now. So that's good.
Well, that's a good sign. It means the average people feel comfortable getting back into the market.
I think what happened, Vic, is my simple opinion, is that when the boy got elected, there was some trepidation saying, what's going to happen? And now I think people realize that nothing earth-shattering is going to happen, that it's all looking pretty positive. So people are jumping in because, like the stock market, it's not being slowed down and stopping. They're anticipating growth in the economy more than last. And people are looking at real estate, if they have any brains at all, and forgive me for saying it that way, interest rates are still ridiculously low, and the value of housing is still lower than replacement costs. So, you know, there's some good deals out there.
Joe, I had somebody saying, but it was a 4.1. I said, what is wrong with you?
Yeah.
Who cares if it's a 4.1? I mean, we were selling 16 and 18%, like we know and we've talked about before, but this is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, give me a break.
Yeah, I know. And, you know, the key is this. If they think 4.1 is bad, wait a year or two from now when it's 5 or 6 or 7, because it's going
to
go up. We both know that.
It has to go up.
Yeah, it has to. You can't keep things artificially low and have the government's, quote, subsidizing at the cost of the taxpayer, which is now all pushing $20 trillion. So, hey, look, at you and I, we're on the same page. And it's hard for people to get it through their heads. They think everybody in the world is going to stay at 2 and 3%. There's no way in the world.
Well, it's very similar to the mentality of the car industry when people wanted rebates all the time.
Yeah,
if
yeah,
I don't get
yeah,
it, I'm
yeah.
not buying it. Well, it was never intended to be a forever thing.
Yeah.
And 2% interest was never intended to be a forever rate.
Well,
I know. So take advantage of it when it's as low as it is and start buying right now, because prices are going to start ticking up more.
Yep.
And you can't go anywhere in this world and get the prices we offer right now.
I agree.
All right, girl.
So,
good luck.
I miss you guys. Have a great day. And
thanks.
Have fun.
You
bye.
Too.
Bye-bye.
340-1590, 340-1590. Let me just give you 1 5-second last. And when I look at the last few people that have come in, we're talking about short-term money and long-term money. And, you know, and there's a monster difference. Short-term means it's liquid. I can buy it today. I can sell it tomorrow. And there's many, many different things that go. In fact, I was with a client this morning, and I'm going to be with another one right after the show, that we're looking at these 6% instruments, 5 and 6%. And the other one is looking at a REIT, Real Estate Investment Trust, and some of these that are liquid are paying 12 to 14%. And people say, Joe, is it safe? And I said, well, you know, the only thing that's 100% safe is the bank, which is going to pay you nothing. When you start getting into something else, and especially real estate, if the market is good and the market is growing, is usually a really good thing to be in. But nothing always goes up like nothing always goes down. So today I tell people, hey, my job is to pay attention to this stuff. Like right now, I think I've got almost 100 clients in these real estate funds that are paying very, very good money. But we can be out of them in 1 hour.
Now, these funds, do you know, like, if they are they New York real estate? Is it
the I ones mean, that I like the most?
Cucamonga?
Are
where
New
is
York.
This?
The ones that I like the most are New York real estate. You know, I just feel very, very
not downtown Detroit.
Not downtown Detroit. No, the ones.
But
that
you
I
might
like,
get a bargain there.
You could get a bargain.
Well,
and
in
the
Ford,
suburbs,
if
just
the auto industry comes back like they predict, it may be a great value.
Yeah.
So the other side of the coin is the ones that are, say, the most conservative. And I say, people, look at you. Look at the variable annuity. You can be in the market. Market goes up and down. But oftentimes the insurance company will say, hey, the insurance company will guarantee you a 5 or 6% income on this for the rest of your life, and it can never go down. It can only go up. Now, you're supposed to know about the insurance company. My compliance people say you have to be concerned about the claims-paying ability of the company. So Dan in the insurance business, Joe Martek, partially in the insurance business, knows I only deal with the highest-rated companies, period, household names. I don't want any grief and aggravation.
Well, no matter what you buy, you should be an educated consumer.
And that's my game plan, is to educate. And, in fact, I spend a lot of time educating people, and I've had some recent clients that have talk to me and trying to get educated, and they can't get learned by their existing agent.
The eyes glaze over.
Well, it's nothing simple unless you know it. 340-1590, and thank you so much. Until next week.
Bye.
Listening to the Team Martek Hour. The Team Martek Hour is a paid program. The content was provided by the advertiser. WPSL, its staff, management, and ownership were not responsible for its content. Investment involves risk. Prior to making any investment, an investor should meet suitability requirements. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future performance. Neither the opinions expressed nor the information provided constitutes a recommendation to purchase or provide investment advice. The material presented is not a substitute for obtaining professional advice from a qualified person or firm. Securities offered through Centaurus Financial, member FINRA and SIPC. Tune in again next Wednesday at 11:05 for the Team Martek Hour here on WPSL 1590.
CBS News is next on WPSL.